guys, today I am with one of my favorite people in the whole world, the universe guru. She is an amazing, amazing, amazing woman. You have got to check out her channel, and I will link it in the description box down below. And then in the last 20 seconds of this video, I'll put a clickable link for you. But she is a frugal millionaire, and she was interviewed by Dave Ramsey's team. And I'll also link that video down below so you can check that out. She and her husband were interviewed, and she is just truly one of the nicest, most genuine people I have ever met in my life. And so I recorded a Skype conversation with her, and we're collabing together on this. And she is going to post on her channel a bit her questions to me about being married to someone who has a different money mindset than you do. I did not link the entire conversation because literally I talked to her for 2 hours. Mina and I talk all the time, all the time. We're texting, we're phone calling, we're emailing. I really hope you guys go over and check her out. I really think she has so much, so much wisdom. So let's just jump on into the conversation I had with Mina.
So tell me, what was it like to be, you know, interviewed by Dave's team and be the frugal millionaire? Because I think that's what everybody kind of knows you as.
It was obviously a rewarding experience. It was fun. I mean, I had mixed feelings about what that would do for my YouTube channel, because I have always prided myself in being, I'm just the average person next door. And so the hiccup that I was thinking that this would cause with that would be that people would not find me relatable anymore, because, you know, how many millionaires do people know? And they're everywhere. They're living right next door to you, but people don't typically advertise this stuff. And so that was my sort of scare. Even though I'm honored, and it was a blessing meeting their team and just being able to interact with, you know, the show and stuff. So I'm honored by that, but I was scared because I felt like people would not be able to relate to me so much anymore. But I think the frugal part of it, and the part of it that, yes, we still live like everybody else. I'm still a mom with 3 kids. I have the same issues that everybody else has. I still have to discuss every purchase that I make with my husband, and he has to do that with me. So, you know, we have disagreements about money like everybody else. We have to think out our purchases like everybody else. So I think it's maybe to some people it makes us kind of unrelatable, but for everybody else, they see that we're still having that same human and marriage experience with money.
That's so interesting that you say you guys discuss every purchase. I kind of feel like that once I get to a certain level, maybe I would not have to literally discuss, Mauricio, I need to buy new socks for Melina today. Is that okay? I'm going to put a couple of bucks in the budget for that. But I guess budgeting really never goes away, does it?
Yeah, I mean, I wish I could tell you that this is something that this is a secret. I have a secret dream that I get to a point one day that we don't have to do that. But the truth of the matter is that because my husband and I have very different money mindsets and different personalities, and I've met him, you know, if he was here, I was here, and we've kind of inched a little bit closer to each other. But the truth is that our differences will never be aligned in a way where we don't have to discuss finances. And I think some of it is because even though I've gotten so much better with money and I've learned so much from my husband, and I hope that he's also learned that it's okay to spend money sometimes. Like, it's okay. Like, it's not, we're not here to hoard money. We're here to enjoy it, right? He gets that on some level, but he still has a little bit of a hard time with it. Mm-hmm. So because of that, I think he needs me to be able to discuss it with him, and also he needs me to give him the permission to spend sometimes. I know this sounds weird, but because we have different personalities, we have to constantly do that for each other. Is it exhausting? Yes, it is sometimes. Yes. That's why I did a video called The Cons and Pros of Saving Money. Sometimes I freaking hate it because I'm like, I just want to go buy something for $2 without Irfan saying, Did you use a coupon? Did you go get a discounted gift card from Kroger? It's annoying sometimes, but this is what got us here. So I would be lying to you guys and to myself saying that, you know what, maybe if we reach $3 million that we would stop. I know that he will still be who he is and I will still be who I am. So that's never going to go away. Remember, money doesn't solve, like, after a certain, I mean, yeah, if you're homeless and you get, $50,000, money will solve a lot of your problems. But after a certain threshold, I guess, it just amplifies your personalities. If you're, whatever insecurities you have, they get exaggerated, and whatever good things you have, they get exaggerated, hopefully. So if that makes sense, like, I've made peace with the fact that even if we are billionaires, that we will still have these underlying like things with our personality and issues, and we're gonna have to discuss stuff.
Well, I know Dave actually says that he still has a budget, and he's got like $55 million, I think was his net worth last year or something like that. And he still has a budget, and he still gets he calls it blow money or his pocket money, whatever you want to call it. And so, and I would imagine when you have that much money that you can, if you want to buy an extra bag of cookies at the market, that you really don't have to think about it, but maybe you do, because you don't.
In the way our house that we right now we're saving 80% of our income. So we are actually the
Wow.
average household income is
That's
50,000. We
insane.
live below that, Wendy. So we live below the average. So a lot of my friends that are complaining at the end of the month that they don't have money to buy groceries anymore, they live a more lavish lifestyle. My friends that have like $50,000, $60,000 household income, they drive better cars, they dress better, they have better makeup. And sometimes I'm not going to lie to you, I have those moments, human moments, where I'm like, oh my God, why can't I do this? But then I like back to reality. Hey, that's, you remember when I was younger, I was blessed enough that I started making in my early 20s over $100,000, but I was spending it on stupid things, like average things that everybody else does. I had a nice car. I was buying clothes without thinking about it. I was getting my hair done all the time, my nails done all. I've been there. And so I have that constant struggle. A lot of people think that it's easy for me because I consider myself a minimalist. And yeah, like you have $1 million. I literally this okay, let me get this is a $10 tripod that I wanted to buy to
I
film. Yes, I had to ask my husband like three times. And he was like, "Why do you need that?" I'm like, "'Cause I'm a YouTuber." Like I so th these are the
That's
decisions
so
that we have.
tripod.
I just want to be real. It never goes away.
Oh my goodness. Well, that is one bonus I do have. Mauricio is not frugal, and we'll be talking about that in our video in a second. But so I never, if I say, Mauricio, I need this because of YouTube, he very rarely will say no. But yeah, I have the same $10 tripod because I can't justify spending $100 on something that holds my camera in the air.
Exactly. The funny thing is that you just said something that, I have a couple of clients that are coaching with me for spending habits and things like that because they've watched my journey and things. So when they say they blame their husband not being frugal and letting them buy whatever they ever wanted for their problem. But I was like, oh, that would be a nice problem to have. If my husband was like, yeah, honey, go buy whatever you want. I love you so much. Like this, I'm like, my husband, that would never be us. Like this is not his personality. We could be billionaires and that would not be him. So I was
No.
just like, oh, interesting how different perspectives, like, to them, that's a big problem in their life. But their
But
husband's like,
I,
honey, do
oh,
whatever you want.
no, I, and we'll get into this more, but it actually is, it makes life a little bit more difficult because we are aiming for the same goal. I mean, legit, we're aiming for the same goal, but his ability to say, do we really need that right now is zero. And sometimes I want something and I really need someone to say, no, you can't have that.
Don't do
But
it.
you probably would like every once in a while him to say, have your fun go, yeah, that would be okay. Not like, do you have a coupon?
Yeah, for $2 things, like sometimes I have to really evaluate that is it worth 20 minutes of time to save 15 cents? And to me, it's not because you know, I'm a life coach, I'm a full-time YouTuber, I'm a full-time mommy, I can spend that time making and earning a lot more money than saving 15 cents. But that's just, those are our differences. And so we've like any other married couple, we've met each other as close as we can, and we're still working on it. We're still a work in progress. And just to clarify, people might be thinking, why the hell are we saving 80% of our salary? But my husband is trying to retire from his job in the next 2 years. It was a 4-year goal initially, and because of my YouTube channel and my life coaching business, we're hoping that we can reach it in 2 years. He does not like his job, and we want to be able to get to a point where we don't need him to work. Just between my coaching, my YouTube channel, and our investments, we should be able to maintain our lifestyle. The goal is 2 years from this date. I'd like to tell you that in those 2 years, my husband will retire, and all of a sudden, like, I'm not gonna have to watch my coupons and do all that stuff. But I've started to become a little bit more realistic now and think that maybe this is how we will have to live, because this is just how it is. And I'm sure he's had to make peace with the fact that she is a girly girl that, you know, will want makeup sometimes and want nice clothes and things like that. So, you know, it's just like every other marriage.
Yeah, and that is true. And that's one thing that my subscribers know that I have a larger salary, and but they subscribe to me because I am just like everybody else. And the amount of money you have doesn't really factor into the kind of person you are unless you let it. And for me, it definitely doesn't. It absolutely
Exactly.
does not.
And that's, I was actually just saying this in a live chat yesterday on my channel, that I've never, even when I didn't have any money, I've never needed to chase money. I've always had a very fluid relationship. One thing I'd like to address, Wendy, and I'm sorry that I'm using your channel as a way of, I guess, replying to a lot of the negative
Please
comments that I got on
go
the Dave Ramsey
ahead.
video. People were saying, oh, you know, she probably married him for money and things like
Oh, that's
that
so
I am
mean.
a gold digger and things like that. The interesting thing is that when Irfan and I got married, he was not only nowhere near worth $1 million. If you know how money works, if he was a millionaire when I married him, we would be way worth
Like a
way more now.
deca-millionaire by
Yeah,
now.
exactly, because you know how fast it grows after you reach a certain point. Not only was he not a millionaire at that point, it was not on his radar. He did not, that wasn't one of his life goals ever. So, and the other interesting thing of that is that the guy that my mom wanted me to marry was worth $7 million. I said no to him because I liked Irfan's personality.
That's
We It was still
interesting.
an arranged marriage, and I've talked about that on my channel
Yes.
culturally, but I chose somebody over personality over $7 million. So I was really surprised to hear comments like that. The interesting thing is, I'm a huge believer in the law of attraction. I actually had on my vision board for years before I met Irfan, that I wanted to become a millionaire. I had always been self-sufficient, working since I was 16, until I was 28 when I married him and became a stay-at-home mom. My son was diagnosed with a learning disability and a disorder, and that's why we decided that it was best that I quit my job, my business, and spend time with him to make sure that he can come out of that. And that is something that I brought, that goal is something I brought to the table. So it
Well,
was very interesting for me to see that people thought I had married for money.
you yourself, I know, and for my people, Mina and I talk all the time, all the time, not just in this Skype video. And I know Mina, you had like a six-figure salary in your 20s, didn't you? Yeah, I vaguely remember you telling me that at one time. So, you were probably earning more than he was before you got married.
That is exactly true. And we both, I owned a condo in Chicago, and he owned a home in South Carolina, and my condo was worth more than the home. And I mean, I had, and again, I mean, not that I'm trying to compare, I was born and raised in the US. My husband's an immigrant, so obviously I had a little bit of an advantage there. And I think that that is disrespectful not only to me. People were saying that, oh, how can a single mom be making a six-figure salary? Because I was an entrepreneur, I have a degree from Northwestern University, but I think it's also disrespectful to my husband, because in turn, they're saying that I married him only for money. My husband is an amazing man with an amazing personality, amazing dad. Like, he's a great guy. I fell in love In the 2 months, we did have a semi-arranged marriage. I had 2 months to get to know him, basically, because we don't have dating and things like that in our culture. You have a very short window of time, but he is who I chose. And I had never even, that thought had never even entered my mind until people on that Dave Ramsey video started attacking me, saying that I was lying, that I never had made, over $100,000. My mom, who was an immigrant to this country, didn't have a proper education. Her last two tax returns before she passed away were $350,000. It is possible. And she wasn't good with money either. She was good at making money, but boy, was she mad. Like, she was not good at keeping it. But it's possible. So, the one thing, the lesson that I've learned from this is that I was shocked to learn how small people's imaginations are and how small people's, like, windows are of what is possible out there. If one thing I can leave you with is that expand your horizons. If you are the type of person that thinks that it's not possible to earn a six figure, you will never earn it. So stop
That
saying
is
that to
true.
yourself, not because it's going to impact my net worth. Trust me, I get comments all the time, all day. I'm still who I am. That's not going to change. I'm still going to do what I want to do. My net worth will not change. But for your sake, please branch out and think big, because that's the only way
Absolutely.
to achieve big.
Well, I mean, Mauricio, my husband, he's the perfect example of that. When Mauricio and I got married, he was a Colombian citizen. He was working as a Colombian police officer, and I think he maybe made $600 a month, maybe. And now he hasn't even really started his US career. And he has months where he's just driving for Uber and Amazon Flexing, where he brings in $6,000 a month, which is, considering it's unskilled labor, that's pretty dang impressive. So, it's all about what you think you can do. I could not agree with you more on that.
So if you're new to my channel, make sure you click on the big black thin face above to subscribe to my channel. And if you are always following me, make sure you go click on Mina's link to go watch her video and then binge watch her channel. I'll see you in the next one. See ya!